The collector's mentality is that you can never have enough. And that's very dangerous.
The biggest toy craze in history.
They would just lunge and grab.
A Beanie Baby is a small stuffed animal that fits in the palm of your hand. You almost feel like the Beanie Baby is a little person. Warner is like the Wizard of Oz. Not many people knew the person.
He knew how to market his beanies. He knew how to get those emotions going.
I would have paid whatever it took to get that Beanie Baby at the time.
We called every shop over the United States.
This was becoming something different.
That's when the internet came around.
Dong, dong.
Things got out of control. There were people out there who were buying the beanies, and this was their livelihood.
The prices were up.
$350.
And up.
$450.
And up.
$900.
My sales in 1996 were $2.6 million, and in 1997, they were $23 million.
Let me tell you a story about a Chinese high who's created these beanies that make me hot. Beanie rap. It's a beanie wrap, it's a beanie wrap. I'm all tied up.
Somebody offered me $100,000. I said no.
Oh man, all right. Yes, do you remember? You're old enough to remember the Beanie Baby craze. Anybody old enough to remember that? Yes, all right. Wow, me too. Of course, these little stuffed animals, people went kind of crazy for them. And it was in the late 90s, so it was a younger-ish type people. This was in the late 90s, mid to late 90s, and then it bubble burst in about 2000. You do the math on the Beanie Babies, and they were sold for, at the time, $5 per Beanie Baby, at the time. Adjusted for inflation, that's about $10 right now. And the idea was, these things were going to be worth a lot of money later, right? There was one guy, he took his daughter's whole college education fund, and he bought Beanie Babies, knowing this was the way to make sure they could pay off the college later. There were people fighting, right, online, eBay. It was like, well, fast forward a few years, you can get these Beanie Babies. Matter of fact, I bought two of them at a yard sale. This weekend, these little guys right here, actually, there's quite a story with this little chameleon guy and this little bumblebee. I bought these this week, and they were two for a dollar. They even had the original tags on them. Here's the original tags on them from the 90s. These were the ones that the McDonald's Happy Meal had, the teeny Beanie Babies. Yeah, now that's we'll talk about that in a little bit here. But literally my granddaughter, Livy, she got a hold of these yesterday. It took her all of 90 seconds to tear the tags off. These had the original tags from 1997 until 90 seconds with my granddaughter. Yeah. So they really might have had some value till she came along, but I've got two beanies. They're going right now. Anybody, raise your hand right here. There's one. Right there is your chameleon. Now, two back there. Okay, there we go. Now, back to the McDonald's Happy Meals. My wife was going to college at the time, that IU, Indiana University, Kokomo, and people would come and buy those. They'd just be in the McDonald's. They'd buy the Happy Meals so they could get the little teeny Beanie Baby, and they wouldn't even eat the food. They'd just throw it in the trash. Well, some people started to take those Happy Meals to college students who were more than happy to have a Happy Meal. I mean, it's still cool. So every day at lunch, it was like, anybody want this for food? And like, yeah, all the college students like, I'll take whatever Happy Meals you're giving out. All for those teeny Beanie Babies, which are on average about 10 cents of what they adjusted for inflation, 10 cents of on the dollar what they once went for. let's just say it wasn't a great investment, right? I guess they still have some value or something, but not a great investment. The Thai guy, he made it so that he would retire some of them at different times. He would just say like, oh, this one's never going to come again. Well, about the year 2000, everybody realized there's not like a scarcity of these things. There's a lot of this, actually. And that's when the whole bubble burst, when it was like, this is one of a kind. Wait a minute, there's 40,000 of these? That's not what collectors are looking for. All right, so we're in a sermon series called The Parables, and we're going through the teachings of Jesus. And today's teaching is a not really, not near as known parable of Jesus as some of the ones we've done up till now. This is the parable of the rich fool. So now this parable is kind of it's a shorter one. We're going to get into it here, but it was a person who did not invest in the proper things. Let's go to Luke chapter 12. Look at the words of Jesus, verse 13. Someone called from the crowd, "Teacher, please tell my brother to divide our father's estate with me." All right, teacher, get involved here in this litigation. And Jesus replied, "Friend, who made me a judge over you to decide such things like that?" Then he said, "Beware. Guard against every kind of greed, because life is not measured by how much you own." Then he told them a story. A rich man had a fertile farm that produced fine crops, and he said to himself, "What should I do? I don't have room for all my crops." And he said, "I know. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I'll have room enough to store all my wheat and all my other goods. And I'll sit back and say to myself, my friend," I like how he talks to himself that way, "my friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Now take it easy, eat, drink, and be merry." But God said to him, "You fool, you'll die this very night. Then who will get everything you worked for? Yes, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth, but not have a rich relationship with God." Now, we've got a lot to go over here today, so I want to make sure we dive deep into this message, because it's easy. Oh, the parable of the rich fool. I'm a poor fool, so I mean, this isn't for me today. Well, check this out. Income across world populations. The top 2 billion people on the planet live on $20 a day or more. That's $100 a week if you're working. The middle here, the billions, 5 or 6 billion live on $10 to $20 a day. 3 to 4 billion live on $5 to $10 a day. And the bottom 2 billion people live on less than $5 a day. So if you make more than $100 a week, you are in the top 25% of incomes. And you're like, dude, I could not survive on that. Exactly. So I want to show, we got to get an understanding that when Jesus starts talking about wealth, it's easy for us to go, that's right. Somebody needs to hear this. Anytime Jesus is talking about this in a global sense, that's you. You could be below the poverty incomes of American poverty levels, you're still, I mean, you're more than $100 a week, I'd guess. You'd have a hard, you'd have to work hard not to make more than that. I mean, minimum wage would be way more than that. So when Jesus is talking about wealth, we got to understand he's talking about us. And this is important because it's easy to go, hey, come on, I mean, yeah, let's talk about money. We don't want to hear that. And to kind of put up a little defensive shield a little bit about these kinds of things, please, this is the words of Jesus spoken with zero animosity in my heart. And from his heart, you can feel that he just wants to help us get a new perspective. So let's look at this. How rich are we? Okay, so if you're in that bottom 25%, out of the 8 billion people, you're at the bottom 1 or 2 billion. Take all your furniture and get it down to just a table and chairs. Take your bedding and remove all that from your house and live on some kind of pad and a blanket. Take all your clothes, take your whole closet and get it down to one outfit and one pair of shoes. Well, take your food, take the refrigerator, empty all that out. Get it down to a little bag of rice, maybe a bag of sugar and a bag of beans. Water, shut that off. You don't have indoor plumbing. Light, electricity, tear out all your electric. You don't have any electricity. Matter of fact, move out of the nice house you have and live in your tool shed out back. By the way, my tool shed would not be a place you'd want to live. Whew, I don't even think the animals want to live there. They're like, we're moving up, Heath. Take your phone. You don't have that. No internet, no phone, no nothing. Take your entire savings and get it down to $10. That's all you would have in your to your name. And then take 25 years off your life expectancy because you have to work so hard to live, you'll die 25 years earlier than most people. So now, once again, open our hearts and just realize, yes, we are blessed. God does not mind us being blessed. God loves that we're blessed. He just wants us to know that we're blessed. Amen. The Lord wants to bless you. He wants to put resources into your hand so you can do something good with it. But the key is for all of us to realize that we are blessed and he wants us to do something with it. That's the point of this parable. See, the Greek word for greed is pleonexia, and it means an insatiable desire to have more. Guard against every kind of greed, pleonexia. More, more, more. You got to get that super new beanie. You got to, $100,000. I can't get past $100,000. Adjusted for $200,000. And she said, no. Oh, my heart. And that little, I've had to watch this video several times in preparation for this this sermon. And that little beanie wrap, that's got in my head all week long. This is the kind of torture I endure for you. Yes. Yes. Pray for your pastor. But it's just more and more. I got to have this one. I throw the food in the trash. Don't even give it to a homeless person. Just throw it in the trash so I can have that. That is not how God's called us to live. And notice he says every kind of greed, because we immediately think when he talks about greed, you know, just money. This is anything we want more and more and more of. It could be, you know, I love spending time with my wife, but if I'm not careful, I'll just like, she's going to spend time with me, and she don't spend time with nobody else, and it's literally greed on my relationship with her. Greed on a person. Greed on a thing. Greed on our time. Where God wants us to let go of our time, but we keep holding on to it. Like, I will do what I want with my time. Man, pleonexia, more, more, more. We got to be very careful, because when we do that, we have no space for God to work in our hearts. We limit the space that God wants to work inside of us. So this parable, it's not about money. It's actually about perspective. You see, verse 15, life is not measured by how much you own. Immediately we jump to money, and I think that's probably a part of it, but it's so much bigger than money. It's about perspective. Realizing we are very blessed. We are very blessed. By the looks of me, I have not missed a meal in a long time. The only meal I missed is the ones I miss on purpose. Right? We are very blessed. And the perspective is all these things, all America and the world, we're clawing for more and more and more. But where is our heart for God? Where is our relationship with God at? That's what Jesus said. You're poor in your relationship with God. And we got to make sure that we are doing the eternal things, and that eternal things have the space in our heart that they need to have. Because if we're not careful, our perspective will just be earthly things, earthly things, earthly things, earthly things, and we miss out on the whole point. Man, I've seen a lot of people, when it comes to their different funerals and stuff like that, one in particular, somebody had passed away, a parent had passed away, and the two children were fighting over what they were going to do with different, just like this parable, what they were going to do with this certain chunk of money, and it was about $1,200. And they were so mad about, I talked to Misty, I literally took her aside and I said, let's just dip into our savings and give this other person $1,200 so at least they can be brother and sister still. Because they were about to nuke the only relationship they now have left for $1,200. Why? Because the perspective was off. Right? They don't realize that's not what matters. That's not what matters, but people will do that all the time. Well, a lot less than $1,200. I like how Jesus in this parable, the guy asks, it starts out with a question. Hey, Jesus, tell my brother to give me what's coming to me. And Jesus is like, what? Now, by the way, in ancient Israel at the time, that would have been common for a rabbi to do the the jurisdiction of those kinds of things. That wouldn't have been, him asking that was not totally out of the realm to ask a rabbi that. Rabbi, tell my brother to give me the inheritance that's mine. And I love how Jesus does it. He goes, let me tell you a parable about a very greedy person. There once was a guy, I mean, some random guy. I love how Jesus tells this parable like it's just to any person when the Bible clearly says, this is you, dude. We're talking about you. Why? Because he wanted to make sure this guy got the right perspective. I love how Jesus approaches things with such truth. Truth sets people free. Actually, the Bible says, Jesus said, you'll know the truth and the truth will set you free. It's actually not the truth. It's when you put it in your heart and say, yes, come on, do something in here, God. That's when the truth sets free. And Jesus actually wanted this guy to be set free. There's another story that where the one man came to Jesus and said, what does it take to be a believer? And he said, you know, here's what you need to do. And then Jesus goes on to explain, you need to now give everything you've got to the poor. And that man went away sad. Well, you know, Jesus' whole point, I actually believe God wanted to use this person. He was just telling him, I want you to join my 12 like these other guys have. This guy could have been the one that maybe would have been the treasurer instead of Judas. You know, Jesus had a plan for this guy, but he couldn't see it. Why? Because it's about perspective. All right, so have you ever asked a kid for a fry? So, it's like a McDonald's sermon today. So I know I shouldn't feed this kid this stuff, but you go through the drive-thru and you get the Happy Meal and you hand the kid the Happy Meal and they're so excited. Maybe you're a parent or an aunt or uncle, grandparent or something. And then those fries start smelling really good. And you thought to yourself, like, I don't need any of that. Oh, I don't need that. And then all of a sudden there's fries there. And you're like, hey, and I was so bad about this when I was a kid. Hey, just give me one of those fries. Oh, they smell so good. Just give me one of those fries. And what does that kid say? No. And they hold on to those fries even tighter now. Like, you ain't getting none of these fries, Grandpa. These are my fries. The point is funny because this kid would not have had a single fry if it wasn't for you giving them those fries. You only have fries, little kid, because I gave you these fries. It's my money. And now going to McDonald's is about $48 to get a Happy Meal. Hand over a fry. But that is a great illustration of our understanding of what God has given us. God gave us everything. Deuteronomy 8:18 says he's given us the ability to gain wealth. He's given us the power to have wealth. So God's even said, I've given you all this. And God's like, hey, can I have a fry? And we're like, no, these are my fries. No. Like, God's like, you wouldn't have anything if I didn't give it to you. Come on, just hand me a fry. No, we've got to share our fries. The Lord wants a fry. Yes, the Lord wants a single fry. And so when we get the right perspective, see, we got to settle the ownership issue. That's what it comes down to. Who owns our stuff? We got to settle this in our hearts. Is this ours? Or is the real root of all this actually God? And if we go, okay, the real root of all my life, everything, I mean, my relationships and my friendships and everything, if this is all really somehow attributed to God, because even if he gave us the ability, the mind to do these things, or the hands to work, if all of that's really still attributed to him, well, we got to let go of a fry. Because the reality is, once we as Christians say, Lord, it's all yours, I understand it's all yours, and I am just a caretaker of your stuff here until my life is in your hands for eternity. I'm just a caretaker. Once we do that, now it's easy. Because, like, Lord asked for a fry. Sure. Man. You know what I've noticed, too? Those that give the Lord a fry get upgraded to the large fry. Yeah. I mean, you'll stay in the small fry unless you give the Lord a fry upgraded to the large. Would you like to supersize that? Yes, Lord. It says it right on our money, in God we trust, but do we trust God? I mean, we say it. Gosh, it's one of those things that's easy for us to say and so much harder for us to actually live. Because we're saying, okay, we're saying goodbye to those things. Like, okay, but we're trusting God. And please, this sermon is not just about money. It's about everything in our life. We're trusting him with all of it. Do we trust him? Because trust comes down to two things. First, we've got to obey. We got to do what he says to do. And you can feel it in your heart. God will say, okay, I want you to take this resource, your time, your money, this whatever this is I've given you, and I want you to put it somewhere else. I want you to use it over here. I want you to do something with it. We've got to obey. We've got to pull the trigger and say, okay, God, it's yours anyway, and I'll do whatever you tell me to do with it. And then when we do that, we need to let it go. It's obey and let go. Because the let go part's important. Because if we're not careful, we'll still hold on. But see, God sees things that you and I will never see. Man, years ago, I had a guy that had this counseling appointment with him. I've told this story before a few years ago. But I had this counseling appointment, and I was in the shower, and the Lord told me exactly what to say to this man. I knew he was having marriage problems, and I knew he had some family stuff. And the Lord told me exactly, and that's not usually how it goes, but the Lord told me exactly what to say. So we were at a coffee house, sat across the table, and I said, the Lord told me what to tell you today, and I laid it out to him. And it was the shortened version of it was, you need to repent. You need to repent before the Lord, before your wife, or you will lose your marriage and your children. You'll lose it all. Well, this did not go over well. He actually stood up, stormed out of this coffee house, and I didn't see him again. Well, for me, I was like, well, thanks, God. Did exactly what you told me to do. I mean, like, to the letter. And what do I get? I get stormed out. And by the way, when the coffee house is full and someone storms out like that, that's really awkward because you still have to pay for these lattes, and everybody saw that go down. So, you know, you kind of sit there for a few minutes like, oh, yeah, meant to do it. Anyway, a couple years later, probably 4 years later, that man, I see him at another different event, surprised to see him. He said, Heath, I want to tell you, thank you for sharing what you shared with me that day at that coffee house. And I know I overreacted, but he did get a divorce. He did lose just about everything, exactly like God had said. Not because I'm great, because God is true and he knows. And he said, I wish I would have listened. But see, during that whole time, those years between the standing up and tearing off and like the moment that he had that conversation, I thought the whole time, I've really blown it. I didn't hear God. I don't know what's going on. Why? Because on the second side of the obedience is the letting go. Where you got to go like, God, I don't know why I just did what I did, and I think I did what you told me to do, but we can't see what all he's working, guys. When we obey him, you got to just trust that the God of the universe, who knows everything and can move all the pieces all around, you got to just trust that the God of the universe has got it in his hands, and he's doing what he knows to do, even if we don't see it with our own eyes. Trusting him. All right, now what if you were starving? And someone gave you a bunch of seeds. You get a handful of seeds here, or a bag full of seeds. Well, the good thing is you could turn it into food. You can grind it up, make some bread. You could take those seeds and roast them and eat them. But we got to make sure we don't eat all the seeds, because if you eat all the seeds, then you don't have anything to plant into the ground to have a harvest for later. And I think that is an important spiritual principle for us, too. God's given us these resources, but we got to make sure we don't eat all the seeds that God gives us, because a certain percentage of those need to be placed into the kingdom of God so that eternal things can take place and so that there's a harvest that comes back. You don't have to plant all of it, but definitely we should plant some of it. And when you obey with the resources God's given us, man, guess what? God begins to put that into the ground like a harvest, and then there's more resources for his kingdom, and more and more and more. And then this parable comes to pass in a totally different way. Because we realize it's not about the stuff. It's about the eternal impact. That's what this is about. When you're giving here at church, this makes it so we can preach the gospel right here in this city. It makes it so we can help you to co-partner with you so you can invite your friends to church and we can help them come to Christ. That matters for everything. So the word of God can be planted into a child's heart right back there in our kids' ministries. So we can do the Love Our City events and people can have a little moment where they realize somebody loves them. And in these dark days, that means everything. Why? Because now we've taken a bit of our seed and we turned it in and we planted it into the ground so that it can have an eternal impact into somebody else's life. All right, I want to tell you a little personal story. Many years ago, Misty and I had a house on Little Pearl Street in Knox, downtown Knox. Little house. We had bought this little house, so proud of ourselves, but we were broke. Like somewhere in that earlier slide, you know? And we decided, it was summertime, we decided to take all the left, I mean, we literally went through our house and through like our car, even our couch, and we got all the change in the whole house. And we pulled it all together, and I had just enough for a milkshake from the B&K drive-in there in Knox. And we decided, it wasn't far from our house, we decided we're going to walk the B&K and we're going to get us a milkshake. By the way, the owner of the B&K goes to one of the Heartland locations. Please feel free to go there and help her out. Because those milkshakes are delish. So that was a side note, right? I don't usually put commercials in my sermons. So we go down there, we take our change. I mean, it was literally even like pennies, and it wasn't just the quarters, you know. We had gone to the low level of like nickels. And so we get to the B&K, we get our milkshake, and it was just like the movie. There were like two little straws coming out, a hers and his straw for the milkshake, the $3 milkshake, whatever we had. And we're walking home, and we're like enjoying our milkshake, and you know, and I tripped over the piece of the sidewalk. Milkshake goes slow motion. Boom. Spills out of her. Not just that, it's in a styrofoam cup. The styrofoam cup, it was the hand of God. It cracked open like, so there was not even any like scooping up, you know, all gone. And Misty and I looked at each other, now I know it's like, come on, it's a milkshake. We were literally near tears. Like, and we knew at that moment, we did, and we were just talking about this. It's the reason why I put this in the sermon. We knew at that moment this was a prophetic thing from God. This was not just like, you know, hey, where's my milkshake? I mean, we love the milkshakes, as you can tell. So the thing God wanted to teach us, and we've talked about this. Now, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with milkshakes, but at that moment, that was my widow's mite. This was literally the last change in our whole house. And I didn't do what God asked me to do with it. Actually, I didn't even ask God what to do with it. I just took it and immediately bought a milkshake. And I knew it was a prophetic word for my family that even in the widow's mite, even in the smallest things, we got to take what God's given us and say, what do you want me to do with this, Lord? Not just what I want to do with it. So I've eaten many milkshakes since, but I think it's a great principle for all of us. Okay, Lord, this is all yours. This is all yours. What do you want me to do with this? So how do we apply this? Two things. Practice daily contentment with what you already have and share your fries. Practice daily contentment. The answer is found in us not just practicing it, because it's easy for us to just be sucked into the world's way of doing things. It's kind of going along with the world's way of doing things. Practice it. Stop and say, thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for this relationship, for this friendship, for all these things that you've given me. And I'm telling you what, man, the perspective just begins to change when we go into practicing a heart of contentment. I don't need more. I don't need that. I'm good. Thank you, God. No, I'm good. And I'll tell you, the funny thing is that when we actually start practicing this contentment, God pours more and more into our hearts because he's found somebody who will do something eternal with it, which is the share your fries idea, right? We just say, okay, God, it's all yours. What do you want me to do? Where do you want me to go? How do you want me to do this? It's all God's anyway. And with that perspective, see, God begins to do something eternal in us and through us. And now it's not all just more things just for the sake of more. It's so that eternal things begin to take place from us. Because there'll be a day when we die. We'll no longer be here. But what we do that has eternal value, what we do for his kingdom, remains. It remains in the hearts of other people. It remains into lives transformed and eternal things. People are in heaven because of what we did. And God wants us to keep the eternal things the right perspective. If I could have every head bowed, please, and every eye closed, we're going to pray right now. You could just feel that this is a solemn moment. A solemn moment. This was the words of Jesus. This parable spoken into our hearts here today. Lord, it's all yours. It's all yours. With everybody online and everybody just in this room, just stay in this head bowed, eyes closed time of prayer, but just in your heart and mind, just say, it's all yours, Lord. It's all yours, God. Everything I have, maybe you need to start listing off some things. My marriage, this is yours. My children, this relationship is yours. Thank you for that, Lord. Every dollar I have, this is yours. My very life, the breath in my lungs, Lord, it's yours. We affirm today that everything is rooted and found in you, Lord. You're so good. God, you're so good. Lord, I do pray for more resources, job promotions, businesses, opportunities into the hands of, Lord, these people as they sow into your kingdom and as they put eternal things first, Lord, bless them. Let us all be pipes of your goodness into the hearts of other people. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.